Hi, I'm Ben Pendery.
And I'm James Hogan. Hello from Cullowhee. This is the May edition of Western Wednesdays. Hey, everybody, it's James here. This is Western Wednesdays May edition, brought to you by the Division of Advancement. Ben Pendery, how are you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Thrilled to be here for the May edition. Golly gracious, we've got a fantastic, fantastic conversation to share with our folks this month, don't we?
It is. It's another English major.
Have we not met our quota?
The saying used to be we were a dime a dozen, and this show is on a budget. So
listen, if every conversation is as good as the last couple that we've had, then bring me all the English majors in the land.
English majors can tell a story, and this one, this interview that you really led with David Joy, is no different. And I'm so glad that we had a chance to bring him into this studio. We were right here and talked to David for a much longer time than you're going to hear. I just want to tell you, there's a lot that we left on the cutting room floor, things that probably should stay on the cutting room floor for the sake of everybody's well-being, but including a terrific post-interview turkey hunt story.
I haven't listened to the turkey hunt story yet. I'm going to try to find it on the floor somewhere. Right. But I was reminded as I was thinking back about that conversation. I led with noting that David was from Charlotte, and I wish I could take that back because he was very quick to remind us that he was from a place that doesn't exist anymore. He's from a place called Paw Creek, which is in the corner, the southwestern corner of Mecklenburg County, and you know, David brings such an amazing, amazing perspective to his writing. He talked a little bit with us about his time right here in Cullowhee as a student and how the faculty embraced him. One of the things that he talked about was he just managed to fall into the right hands.
Oh my gosh, and not just anybody's hands, but Ron Rash's hands. And that's one of the things that we talk about this in the interview, but that's one of the things that makes WCU such a special place is that this is the kind of place where you can end up in somebody's lap like David Joy did in Ron Rash's lap and his hands. And that's so special.
We get to work in engagement, obviously, and we get to work with our alumni, with donors, with supporters, with stakeholders. And, you know, one of the things that I've found and that I'm sure you have too, James, is that it happens at a higher rate here at Western and that the folks that we talk to, even the community members here in Jackson County, they find a way to people here at Western, whether it's a faculty member, whether it's an expert staff member like George Frizzell, who ran Special Collections.
Right, right.
You know, they find those people here who care so much about their so much about their passions and about the things that they're great at, and Western has a place of cultivating those things.
That's it. And there's so many stories we look forward to telling you this entire season. David's is just one of them. It's very special. You know, we hear also a little bit about why David's not a teacher. And also though, just a touch about just sort of the things that he brings to bear when he sits down to write a book and what it takes out of him. It's a very consuming thing for him, as you'll hear.
It becomes everything about how he spends his time when he's working on a book, when he's working on a character, when he's bringing these characters out of his mind and putting them onto paper. I was drawn into how he talked about his process and talked about craft, and then you know to when he would talk about how he's trying to educate people about ways that have been forgotten. You know, we hear about how he spends his free time, and you know how he gravitates towards. Towards older folks, and so I think that it's a really special interview that I think a lot of people, all of our listeners, will find something to relate to.
To hear it from somebody who is of our generation, our age,
yeah,
is different, right?
We were all here at the same time. We didn't really know it at the time, but we all overlapped, I think, for at least a semester here in Cullowhee.
It's pretty wild, you know. So for those of you who are watching this on YouTube, first of all, thank you for watching. If you're listening to this on Spotify or some podcast service that you use to listen to Western Wednesdays, I just want to describe to you that this interview is conducted with a man with a full beard, with a camouflage shirt on and a camouflage hat on. And so if you go listening to this podcast thinking, you know, hi, I listen to my university's podcast and it has some great academic, like this, I think, is such a WCU moment. And I think it speaks so much to who our alumni are. They're such accessible, genuine people. And for a novelist who makes a living writing books, to present the way that David Joy presents, to defy the stereotypes the way that David Joy does it. I mean, this man has read his books in front of the most sophisticated audiences in the most gilded palaces in France. And here he is, you know, in this studio about to go out into the field to hunt turkeys. It's pretty cool.
It's very cool. And before we kick you over to the interview, a reminder that Those We Thought We Knew is the new novel from David Joy. It's available for pre-order. If you're close by to Jackson County, check out City Lights Books, our favorite independent bookseller here in Western North Carolina. And we'll send it over to the interview. Can't wait. David, thank you so much for being with us on Western Wednesday. It's a real pleasure to have you. We're honored that you'd give us some of your time. And so we've got just a few questions. We'd love to have a little conversation if we could.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. So WCU class of 2007, and then you loved it so much, you hung around for a master's degree in 2009 in professional writing. That's fantastic. So you grew up in Charlotte, North Carolina, admittedly a very different Charlotte, North Carolina than we probably see today. Can you talk a little bit about why you chose Western Carolina University?
I think to explain like where I came from, because you hear that Charlotte now and it don't make sense. You know, my family settled there in kind of mid-1700s. My father's family, I'm a 12th generation North Carolinian. You know, my father's family especially had settled around there by, you know, mid-1700s. And so I grew up to a very rural people who had kind of been encapsulated by a city. You know, I grew up in Paul Creek, and Paul Creek's no longer there, just like Steel Creek's no longer there. But you know, I grew up running through a cow pasture every day and fishing a farm pond, or my uncle was 3/4 of a mile down the road and he still ran rabbits and kept rabbit dogs. But I went to inner city schools. So it was really, I'm an enigma to a lot of people because it just doesn't make sense, right? But what brought me here is the thing that brings, you know, all 18-year-old boys where they wind up, which is a woman. You know, which was, you know, I was chasing a girl. And she had her head on a lot straighter at the time than I did. And so, yeah, originally I wanted to study fish, and I was going to go to Wilmington. I actually had a scholarship to go to Wilmington, and I just kind of threw that out the window, decided I wasn't going to go to school at all, and then wound up chasing a girl and following her up here. And that's how I wound up here.
That's a great story.
We're going to send her a postcard, a thank you note.
We really should.
Don't mention me.
For undisclosed reasons. Yeah. Thank you.
If anyone hasn't picked it up or taken a look at it, Growing Gills was a fantastic read and one of the first things that you published. It's available on Apple Books. It's available on anywhere books are sold, Amazon, and so you should check it out. But it really was a fantastic read talking about fishing.
Yeah.
On the coast.
Yeah.
And so are there things, you know, you mentioned the girl. Is there something about that decision that sticks out in your mind when you thought about Cullowhee? Had you visited up here? You were fishing up here, obviously.
Yeah. It was like when I look back on what brought me here, it was her. But then when I look back on it's like the universe aligned, right? Like I wound up in the perfect place. Like I came up here, another thing that doesn't, I knew I wanted to write, but when I say I wanted to write, people imagine fiction or they imagine poetry, and the truth is at the time I was writing music. I was writing rap music, you know, like had been on the radio in Charlotte, I wrote rap music. I came here and decided I wanted to, you know, I'd kind of heard people always said you want to be a writer, you got to read. So it was like, well, all right, that's what I'll do. I'll come up here and I'll study literature. And Newt Smith was still working in the English department at the time, and that's who I met. That was the first person I ever met from the English department. And I just wound up in that department at a really good time, and I kind of fell in the hands of some people who were able to foster what I wanted to do. But then as far as place, as far as what wound up keeping me here, I think it was that I saw something that was gone from where I had come from. Like, the place where I – it's Gertrude Stein, right? Gertrude Stein said about Oakland, she said, there is no there. There is no Paul Creek there. I can't take you to where I grew up. The place doesn't exist. The people don't exist. They're gone. The language is gone. The food is gone. Everything that was there is gone. And when I came here, I started, you know, meeting people whose value sets reminded me of the people that I had come from, and where landscape still mattered, and where stories still mattered. And so really, when I think about, you know, what kept me here, it was all of those things. It was that I wound up within a really good department and had some people who were really able to foster what I was trying to do. But it was that I was able to reclaim something that had been taken from me, which was landscape and people.
There's a line in 13 Moons, Charles Frazier is talking about a Cherokee elder, and they're describing Oklahoma to him, and they say, you know, that's the flatness out there. And the elder, and I'm paraphrasing, I'm sorry to not nail it, he says, I don't know what I'm going to do in a place so flat. The mountains here help hold me in. I feel like I might fall right off the side. And so when you talk about the power of this kind of place, it holds these people in. Yeah. That's really moving. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the faculty that you found here who helped provide a sense of that place.
Yeah, so the first professor who really kind of took me under their wing was Annette Debo, who is department head now. And part of it was because of what Annette was studying. You know, Annette was studying African-American lit. She was really – that was at a time period where hip-hop was just starting to kind of find its way into, like, literary circles. Like, you know, you just had deaf poetry jams. You had all of these things. Slam poetry was just coming about. You had artists like Common who was putting people like the Last Poets into a song. And all of these things were, like, intersecting at once. And she came from an academic background where she didn't understand that, versus that was all I understood, right? And so she had something that she could offer me, and I had something that I could offer her. And so she was able to put books into my hands that wound up shaping me, and I was able to help her in some ways understand that intersectionality between hip-hop and literature that was taking place at the time. And I wound up doing an independent study on that. And part of the reason was it was like in those English classes, I've got all of these academics telling me, well, this is what makes this work, right? Like, and so you're talking about alliteration, or you're talking about, you know, whatever. Maybe you're talking about rhyme schemes in a poem, right? And this is this way because it's a Shakespearean sonnet. And I was able to talk about that through terms of hip-hop. It was like, you want to talk about alliteration and say that it's important in this poem, like I'll play Papoose's Alphabetical Slaughter, where he works his way from A to Z through the alphabet, just, you know, rhyming words that off the same letter. But so that was like the first person who took me under their wing. I started writing, I was writing short stories. Like, I was writing poetry, I was writing short stories. And I finally had a short story that I thought was decent. And so I took it to Annette Debo and I said, I'd really like you to read this. Like, I really respect you. And I think I would just like to know what you think about it. And she said, David, that's not what I do. And I said, okay. And she said, but let me introduce you to somebody who that's what they do. And she took me next door and she dumped me out in Ron Rash's lap. And
crap.
Yeah. Which, and you know, and this is
there were no other laps around, I guess. Yeah. So Ron's next door. Yeah.
It was like this was Ron Rash too before he was Ron Rash. You know, quote unquote Ron Rash. Like, this is like 1 foot in the. He might have had Saints at the River out, but he was far from a household name at this moment in time. You know, this is pre-Serena. It was that she didn't know what to do with me, and so she dumped me in his lap. I'd never taken a creative writing class or anything like that, and so he and I became friends really first and foremost, and that friendship developed over fishing. But then he started giving me books. He started critiquing things that I was doing. I look back that very first, the story was called The Legend of Willie Simmons and the Uncatchable Fish, and it was shit. It was shit.
Right.
And everything that I was writing at the time was, you know. But I just, you know, that's how I got dumped in his lap, right? And there was everybody always thinks it had to, that's what shaped me was Ron. And it was. But there was a woman working in that department at the time named Deidre Elliott, mm-hmm. who is one of the most talented nonfiction writers I've ever read. And it was her. Mm-hmm. Like, who I owe the most to, like, who shaped me was Deidre Elliott. And without her, really, I mean, without all of them, but without her, I'm not, this doesn't happen, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I would have wound up probably doing something else.
You know, one of the things I love about this place is it's the kind of place where you can get a tenured faculty member or even a visiting faculty member to do that with you. Like nowhere else, but very few other places are you going to get dumped in Ron Rash's lap.
Yeah.
Even before he's Ron Rash.
Yeah.
Very few other places are you going to get a faculty member who's going to say, okay, well, I like this part. The rest of it, not so much, but I like that part. Go with that. That just doesn't happen everywhere.
Yeah.
But it's strangely, it happens here.
Yeah. Or the ability to hand people books. Yeah. Like when I really think about the thing that shaped me most, it was that. Mm-hmm. And I didn't grow up as a reader. Like, I didn't read. Nobody ever handed me a book I liked. Like, I can think of the books I liked as a child, and there was only two. It was Dion Meyer's Fallen Angels and Gary Paulson's Hatchet.
Yeah.
That's it. And then I get here and people start handing me books that, like, they knew what I was into, and they just hand me a book. And, like, that's really when you fall in love with language and fall in love with literature. And, yeah, I don't know that would have happened very many other places,
And you've elected to stay here, and so you live here. You're a part of the community here in Jackson County. What is it about the place here in Western North Carolina that you've decided to make your home? Obviously drawn to something and maybe a lack of home, you know, to go back to. Could you talk a little about that?
Yeah. Well, it's landscape, one, but it's also people and culture. And the sad part is that I think we're at a moment in time where it's blinking out like a sunset, like we're on the brink of cultural extinction. And this place, and the same thing that happened to where I come from is happening to this place. And it's like, I look at, like, I had somebody tell me the other day, I wanted to hit him when he said this. We were talking about the mill in Canton, right? And he tells me, oh, well, you know, in the end, this is going to be a good thing. He's like, they'll be able to bring in all of these things. And he starts telling me all this stuff. And here's the reality is that mill shuts down. Those people can no longer afford to live where they live.
Yep.
They're priced out. They're gone.
Yeah.
They're gone, right? And then eventually, like, none of it's left. And so, like, I'm already thinking about, like when it's gone, where do I go? Right, because it's happening fast,
in a blink of an eye.
Yeah,
in the blink of an eye. I like to believe that our rural community here has something to teach the outside world about community, about interdependence, but at the same time about self-reliance. And so that mill, as a reflection of that, and a lot of what people still do here. You spend a lot of time outside practicing skills that many people have either never learned, never wanted to learn, or forgotten. Do you think those skills come through in your writing as a desire to try to educate someone or inform other people? I mean, You're obviously not shy about sharing your thoughts on things that are happening socially, you know, both in this community and communities where you've lived. And so, how does that come through in your loudest medium or your most available medium?
Like, I think it's that, the people that I've, like, I'm not friends with anybody my age. Mm. Like the youngest friend I have is 64 years old, right? And most of them are closer to 80. The things I value are very, very different. And when I look at the way that value set is changing, is one of the things I don't know where I belong, right? But so that still exists here, right? Like I still go sit 2-3 days a week. I still go sit at a gun shop, and it's just me and a bunch of old men sitting in there, and me just listening to them. It's the way they phrase things. It's the way they look at the world. Like all of those things, I think is really what keeps me here, and then what finds its way into the fiction, right? Because the fiction is trying to reflect a reality, and I'm writing about a very specific people, right? And so all of my novels have been very specifically set within this county. I think a lot of fiction writers, they try to create a world. And the truth is that world winds up being kind of this reflection or this mirror image of a real place, mm-hmm. right? Like they're imagining it, and it's this made up place, but no, it's not. It's Oxford, Mississippi, mm-hmm. right? Or no, it's not. It's Spartanburg, South Carolina. Like it's a real place, but they're not wanting to, for some reason, they're trying to do that. I never wanted to do that, right? Like for me, when a story arises, I know where the character's standing. The first time I ever dreamed up Aiden McCall and Thad Broome in The Weight of This World, I knew the patch of trees they were standing under. Like, I can take you and I can put you under the tree. You know, they were standing at the top of Sugar Creek, at Sugar Creek Gap, and there's an old set of balsams right there. You can see them balsams from mountains all around there, and anybody who's ever been up there knows it. But so for me, when I see a story, I know they're in a place, and it would be a disservice to make it up, right? Like I would rather just capture the place for what it is.
I know this in Growing Gills. I know the spot on Caney Fork Creek when you talk about the air being penetrating and how it gets through your clothes, it shakes your skeleton, and it makes you look at the world in a different way. And you're talking about that in that writing. You're getting ready to get in the water and fish on a cold winter day. Yeah. But your writing has been described constantly as penetrating, and I think anyone who has read something that you've written would say that it has a way of getting in and shaking the way that you're looking at the world. And my question is, do you write to try to break through a barrier? As much as any writer probably does, but do you have a specific barrier in mind for the reader that you're trying to break through to help them see the world in a different way?
Early on, I'd say no, right? I think that I'm far enough along in my career at this point. Like, you know, there's the fifth novel's about to come out. That'd be my sixth book that's published. I think I'm far enough along to notice where these shifts took place, right? Like Growing Gills, I wrote that. I was still in school here. That was my graduate thesis. I don't think that I was old enough to have perspective on some of the things that I was writing about, right? So like, for instance, development that was taking place in the county at the time. I think I lacked space to have any type of real insight into what I was talking about. I was just angry. But I can also see things that I was starting to do well, and the things that I was starting to do well was that attention to language, like the sound of language, and especially the writing about landscape. That's something that I still do very well. But with those early novels, you know, I was just they started with images, had no idea where they were going. I followed blindly, like where all light tends to go. The end of that novel, I don't know what happens in that book until I'm there. Like when I'm writing the last chapter is when I realized everything that had happened, right? There was no plotting it out, or there was no, storylining the thing out and saying this is what I'm going to write. And there
and
was
here
also
we are at the end.
Yeah, you know, and there was also no desire to do anything other than to tell a compelling story.
Yeah.
Right? Like I didn't care what the book did. I was really obsessed with writers at the time who were able to just put their foot on the gas pedal and not let off. Mm. Like Daniel Woodrell, you know, I can remember the first time I read Tomato Red, and I'm a slow reader. But I was like 30 pages in before I took a breath. And I just went back and I read it again. I was like, how did he do it? Like, how did he do it? And so then it was like a study of okay, this, and then it's like, this is what I want to do. Like, I want to tell a propulsive story. And so early on, it was that, right? And every book has been a little different. But when I get to When These Mountains Burn, yes, it was very much, I want to write about something that's happening. And it was because I had left Jackson County at the time, and I was just over the line in Haywood, but I was living with Ashley at Plot Creek. And there was a whole lot of the majority of heroin in that county was moving, you know, about a quarter mile up the road. And so every day there was addicts wind up in our yard. They'd, you know, knock on the door. They'd ask her for sewing needles. They were trying to skin pop or you know, you'd ride into town and I'd go to the post office and I'd step out and there'd just be syringes all across the parking lot. Or I'd go into, you know, I'd go into Hazelwood and see medics pulling a body out from under the bridge or out of a gas station bathroom. And the opioid crisis had become this inignorable reality. And so with that novel, yeah, I very much wanted to write about that. And with this novel that's coming out, it was similar in that I had something very specific that I wanted to write about. And it felt bigger. And it felt socially important. And now what I'm working on now feels like a complete reversion. Like I'm back to, I just want to see how fast I can make a story go again.
Is that exercise for you? Is it?
I think it was that those two books where the ideas were bigger and the scope was bigger absolutely destroyed me. Mm-hmm. Like they emptied me, especially this last one. Like at the end of that, you know, that novel took me 5 years. There's never been a novel that's taken me that length of time. That first novel, I wrote it in a month and a half.
The Weight of This World?
No, Where All Light Tends to Go. I wrote that novel in a month and a half. But so it was, as the things got bigger, how many chips you had on the table was just, the stakes were like stupid high, especially on this novel that's coming out. And I think they were stupid high with When These Mountains Burn. Versus those other novels, there really weren't stakes. Either you liked the book or you didn't. But because those stakes were so high and there was so much that I could potentially get wrong, those books really, really emptied me. And I'm not quite ready to be emptied again like that.
Take it in a way that reserves some for you, that you can continue to have your wits about you, I guess?
Yeah.
We're going to take a quick break from the interview to send you over to Stacy Miller, our Director of Alumni Engagement, who's been talking with some of our alumni who just came back last month for the WCU Soccer Alumni Reunion. So let's hear it from Stacy.
So we're here with the legendary Coach Ralph Lundy. We'll talk a little bit about his time at Western. So, Coach, what years were you here in Cullowhee?
I came in 70, transferred from Brevard Junior College, finished in 72 with a bachelor's degree, and then I came back in 75 to be Coach Schrader's assistant and to get my master's degree.
That's awesome. Can you tell us what dorm you lived in? You know, this is a big thing. It's a big thing we talk about here at Western.
Yeah.
We love to group ourselves and identify ourselves by what dorm we lived in. So, what dorm did you live in when you were in Cullowhee?
I lived in Albright Benton, 1 year in third floor Albright, and my senior year in the basement of Benton. And then in graduate school, I lived up there, and five of us and actually six of us lived in a great big house up there in the hills. A new, pretty new house, very nice. And, you know, graduate school was just, all my time here was just wonderful and tremendous. Oh, my gosh.
That's awesome. Have you seen our new dorms over there?
I can't believe it.
They're beautiful, huh?
My gosh. That's amazing.
They're beautiful. We have air conditioning. What do you think about that?
at times, but I can tell you this, it was never a problem when I was here.
Right.
Not having air conditioning in Albright Benton. I can never remember having a terrible time with heat.
Can you share with us your greatest soccer memory at Western Carolina?
Well, I won't try to be singular about that. What I'll tell you is the camaraderie of the teammates I had and the leadership of Coach Schrader and then the players I coached when I came back and was coach's assistant. So the greatest joy is these people that I shared colloquy with.
What does it mean to you to have this alumni reunion weekend still going all of these years later?
It means so much to always. And, you know, we, all these guys, we're in contact all year around, and we do things together when we go to different people's towns. And it's camaraderie. It's sharing this special place. And Cullowhee is a special place. There's no doubt about it. So it means so much to have this happen every year. And it's wonderful.
And you guys, the men's alumni, as you call yourselves, the old timers now, have done an excellent job of supporting this women's program here. But, Coach Lundy, you have a very special connection to this women's team. Can you share that with Catamount Nation?
Well, in Charleston, I train all the players and all the youth players, and they come to my camps and they kind of grow up with me. So the DeMarco sisters, who are just unbelievable girls, I was fortunate enough to be great friends with their dad, and he came to me and said, "What do you think?" And I said, "What I think is you all need to go to Western Carolina University and play." So Alexis was the oldest, and she came and loved it, and then her sister followed, and they love it, just like I love it.
Great. We're going to throw it back a little bit, back to your days here in Cullowhee as a student. What one meal can you think of that reminds you most of your time at Western?
So every generation says, this younger generation is so spoiled. But in the cafeteria, you got one meat, you got two vegetables, you got one piece of bread, you got one dessert, you got one beverage. That was it. And now we did fine. And actually, they would put out big trays of tomatoes that they would buy from the local farms, and we'd get extra bread and we'd make mayo and tomato sandwiches. But the plate was full. And it was good food, and the cafeteria did just fine. And that's where I ate every meal. I didn't go out to restaurants or anything like that. And there were no there was a Cullowhee Cafe and this and that, but we never went there. So that meal was a meat and vegetables and, a good meal for you. So anytime, I love that kind of food. And I like home cooking, and I love a meat and three vegetables, and that's probably a lot because of Western Carolina University.
Awesome, Coach. Thanks so much for being here with us this weekend. Thank you so much for your support, your continued support and engagement with Western Carolina, and we appreciate you.
God bless you. Thank you.
Go Cats.
In the weight of this world, we're introduced to a character who's a return from a conflict. And it made me think about the idea of patterns and getting caught in a pattern. And maybe this is something that one can see in other things that you've written. Do you think there's, when you think about patterns that people get caught in, whether it's whatever is in their community or the family or their whatever they feel like they might be stuck in, whether it's drugs, do you think that it's hard and for our society to break those patterns, and that is a part of what we're facing, whether it be violence or drugs or just rampant, you know, economic growth for the sake of growth? And how do you change those kinds of processes? How do you change those patterns? And maybe what role have they played in some of your writings as you're thinking about the characters that you've developed?
Well, I think I've always written about working class characters. And I've written a lot about addiction, and part of that was that I grew up, you know, surrounded by addiction. And so it's something that I understand very, very well. And so I think the tendency was to try to tell those stories early on, just because it was the stories that I knew. But yeah, as far as there's a writer named Megan Abbott, and one time, you know, people say I write crime fiction, and whether or not that's right, I don't really know, but there's a really brilliant writer named Megan Abbott, and she and I were in France together one time, and we were on a panel together, and she said that she thought that the crime novel could serve as the social novel in America. And I think she's right. Like, if you look at drugs, you look at poverty, you look at crime, like all of those things are typically happening for social reasons, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think with the novels, it's kind of I don't know that it was something I was trying to do either. You know, it was just I was writing about the people that I knew.
The idea of addiction and breaking those patterns, you know, ends up being something very difficult for some of the characters who just can't break out of a cycle. And I think about our community that we all live in, and I think it's interesting that all three of us, we were here as students between 2000 and 2007, and the experiences that we've had that have shaped, you know, how we've arrived here at the table. And so you're a hunter and someone who counts on patterns and who follows that really closely. You know, changes in those things can be really difficult for a lot of people. And so obviously your characters have found it very difficult to break out of patterns that they found themselves in.
Well, and the patterns that we're talking about are not patterns that are easily, if ever, broken in this country. So, you know, I'm writing about poverty. The poor remain poor, right? Like, that doesn't change. Or in this new novel, I'm writing about race, you know, and whether anybody, you know, this is no secret because it's in this upcoming novel, you know, but historically up there where Robertson Dorm is, was one of the oldest churches in this county, right? The original site of an AME church started by 12 formerly enslaved people, right? Like, there's a cemetery there. And in such and such date, they have to dig up the dead and move them to the bottom of the mountain. Now, there's two other cemeteries on this campus at that point in time, right? So why is one of them moved and the others ain't, right? And it's the same thing that's happening right now. Like, that's no different. Things don't tend to change in this country. Like, this is a country that was founded upon and perpetuated by white supremacy, right? And capitalism. And so the things that I'm writing, the cyclical nature of those things, I think the fiction reflects that reality, right? Like, I'm not making it up. Right. And so I think with all of the things that I'm writing, I'm trying to shine a light on it. And I'm trying to make you think about things that maybe you're not thinking about. Like, that's what literature and art is really supposed to be doing. You know, George Saunders said, you know, fiction, when it's done well, has the capacity to serve as empathy's training wheels. And I think that's right. You know, I think the role of literature is to allow people to walk in someone else's shoes for a little while, and to do so in a safe environment. You know, in this country, we have a really hard time talking about things that are difficult. We have a hard time talking about class issues. We certainly have a very hard time talking about race. We have a hard time talking about gun reform or all of these things. And the tendency is to become a screaming match, right? Like we all just get fucking mad and yell at each other. But with literature, you have the ability to sit with ideas that aren't your own and to do so in a place that's personal, right? Like you can get mad at the book, but the book's just going to sit there, right?
The book can't yell at you.
Yeah, and so I think you've got this chance to sit with ideas that challenge you.
How do you think, because I completely agree with you, we yell at each other so much, and we have so many instruments now to yell at each other with. We have so many little dens of yelling at each other, and it's not productive, clearly. I mean, Twitter has not solved the great debates of this world. I think it's made a lot of things worse. How do we have those conversations, particularly with people who look like us, who may not be receptive to those ideas, people who immediately get defensive, people who are maybe working in that mill for the last couple weeks in Canton, who this is their livelihood, and you're going to tell me that I'm privileged and struggle with that idea. Is that through storytelling? Is that through?
I think that's the safest way to do it. I think that the role of art, I've always said, I think the role of art is twofold. Like, first and foremost, it has to elicit some emotional response. Mm-hmm. And I don't care what that is. I just care that you feel something. Whether that's anger, okay. Whether it makes you laugh, that's great. I want you to feel something. If you look at a painting, you ought to feel something. You look at a photograph, you ought to feel something. If you read a book, you ought to feel something. And I think the other thing it should do is to illuminate some aspect of the human condition. And so I think art is a very safe place to interact with ideas that are challenging to us. As far as how this country gets back to a place that can have civil discourse and dialogue, I don't know. One of the things I loved about France, Ashley and I was sitting at a dinner one time, and all these people start screaming at each other. And I thought somebody's about to pull out a knife and cut somebody. You know, I mean, they're all just screaming in French, and Ashley and I are just like sitting there backed up, like, what in the hell is happening? And all of a sudden, one of them stops, and she just starts laughing because she could see we're both like, you know, scared, like, what in the hell is happening? And she's like, no. She's like, this is just what we do.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And I still to this day don't remember what they were arguing about, but all of them disagreed. Everybody disagreed with everybody else, and they were all screaming at each other, like at each other's throat. And at the end of the day, it was just a conversation. Like there was no respect lost. There was no like harbored anger outside of it. But they were, you know, and I've never witnessed that in this country. Right? Like those types of things don't happen. And so really the only thing I can imagine is you would have to be teaching kids how to do that, you know, from the get-go.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how you do that. And I especially don't know how you do that when they go home and then they witness the opposite of that. Like, I don't know how you bridge that gap. At the end of the day, I've thought a lot about this lately. Like, the thing that I'm most fearful of and the thing that I refuse to live in is a place of homogeny, right? Like, I am so sick of this country being like everybody's got to talk the same. Everybody's got to – I don't want none of it, right? Like, and that's the thing. When I'm talking about cultural extinction, it's those things. It's loss of food ways. It's loss of language. It's loss of all of these things. And that scares the hell out of me. I don't want to live in that world. I don't want to live in a world where when I go to Maine, they don't talk like they're from Maine. Or when I go to Boston and they say pike, or let's go pike the cow, or however they talk. I don't know how they talk.
Yeah.
But I don't want to go there and them not talk like that.
Right.
And I don't want to go to North Carolina and them not talk like me, yeah, or talk like somebody that's from the mountains, or talk like, you know, talk like Charlie, who grew up on the coast, you know, all of these different, like that, it's rich. It's rich. I don't want to eat bland food. I don't want to live in a bland culture. Like, I don't want pasteurization, a pasteurized culture. I don't want to live in a pasteurized space. And so for me, like, the influx of people here, the thing that I fear, I don't know, it's that. Like, mm-hmm, that's what I fear.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I don't want no part of.
And there's kind of a conflict there, though. You know, to diversify a place means that you lose some of the historical tradition of a place, because if you're new, you're going to change the environment, right? It's kind of like biology. If you introduce an invasive species into an ecosystem, it's going to disrupt it. Even if you observe it, you're going to disrupt it. But at the same time, when you don't, it can perpetuate things that,
yeah.
And that's tough.
Oh, yeah.
If you were sitting in an office in Coulter as a visiting professor of creative writing.
Sounds horrible already.
So you're watching the clock, right? You're like, oh, God, I have an office hour. I have to be here for 60 minutes. And Ron has already checked out to go trout fishing. And Annette Debo comes by and says, Ron's not here. I'm sorry. And I've got this kid. Can I dump him in your lap? And here comes young David Joy into your office. And he's got this story that's kind of shit. What do you say to young David Joy?
There's a reason I wouldn't be in that office.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is when I looked, you know, everybody thinks I must teach somewhere, right? When they say, well, what do you do for a living? I say, I write. And they're like, yeah, but what do you do for a living? It's like, no, I make a living writing novels, you know?
Yeah.
And so the immediate thought is that I teach, right? I'm not a teacher. I've never taught. And it's because I recognized very early, I watched some very brilliant writers be destroyed by that profession. So like Deidre Elliott, wholeheartedly one of the most talented writers I've ever read, never published a book. Virtually nobody knows her work. If I think about why that is, it's because of how brilliant of a teacher she was. And it's because she gave every piece of herself. There was nothing left.
Mm-hmm.
And there's other, Ron, I think, is one of the few that I think was able to strike a balance. And Ron's an incredible teacher, but he was always able to hold something back for himself. He was very different from Deidre in that way. Pam Duncan is another who I think, you know, absolutely has given everything of herself to her students. And from the student's perspective, that's a really great place to be. I'm selfish. I'm not giving you anything, right? Like, that's mine. I can't even really entertain that conversation because I would have been incapable of
it. David, turn around and just leave. You know, take it back.
I would have been incapable of doing it.
Yeah.
Like the writing for me, I've never had a writing community. I've never had, it's just a very personal thing. And it's that it's like when it's going, like when I'm actively working on something, it absolutely consumes me. Like there is nothing else. There's nothing else. That's the world, right? And like the regular world still goes on. You still got to go to the grocery store and buy groceries, or you got to go run an errand or this or that. And when I walk into Walmart, it's like I'm walking through a dream world. It's like that place isn't even real. And it's because everything that's going on in my head is my reality at that moment in time. And so I personally have never been able to navigate those worlds where I could move in and out, and I've never been willing to give enough of myself to someone else to where I would have been a valuable teacher. I think that's a gift that I don't have.
Maybe not now. Is there a point in the horizon where you put a pin in it and say, you know, like, I'm done? And a lot of authors have done that, right?
Yeah, I could see myself reaching that point. I think I'm more likely to go sit at the Dollar General or something. Yeah. I mean, and part of it is like, man, I can't even stand to be around academics most of the time. that sounds horrible given where I'm sitting. But
I just can't.
Yeah. I don't know. Deidre Elliott always had this idea that, like, the writers didn't need to be in culture with the English department. The writers needed to be over here, you know, in the Bardo Fine and Performing Arts Center, sitting beside people with clay on their hands and paint on their shirt. And I think there's a truth to that. Her argument was that we're two entirely different things. Yeah. And so the English department's this really oddball place where you've got
that's what I've always heard.
It is. And the other thing about that, that it would probably be the hardest place to work in a university, in any university in America, in the sense of Comp 1 and Comp 2.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, would I put myself in that environment? Hell no. Wouldn't do it. Like, if tomorrow Ron said he was leaving and they were like, David, you can be the Paris Distinguished Chair of Appalachian Studies and you can make six figures. I say, no, I can't, because I'm going to be chasing turkeys. Right? David can't do it.
Yeah.
Can't do it.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to find people who value things the same way that I value.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even people that are good friends. There's a buddy of mine, and he went here. He actually works here now. But, like, he wanted to get into carp fishing. I'm obsessed with carp and catfish especially. But so he wanted to get into carp fishing. So, like, I teach him to carp fish. He wants catfish, so I teach him to catfish. He wanted to turkey hunt, so I start showing him turkey hunting. But, like, there was a day there was a bird gobbling behind his house. You call in sick. Like there's no questions asked. There's a bird gobbling his head off when you walk out to your car. If you don't call in sick, we're not the same person. We don't value the same thing.
Yeah.
Like, what I'm getting at is, even then, even when the value sets align, like, there's this, I don't know. The things that I'm interested in is all there is. So, like, with the novel, it's all there is. Or with turkeys, it's all there is. Or deer, you know, when it's deer, it's all there is. I think that it's hard to find people that obsessive. I think they're kind of a rare breed.
I want to try to bring us back a little bit, and I'm so grateful for your time, David. I want to bring us back to the role of a place like Western Carolina University, where you can walk into an English department with someone like Annette Debo. You can walk 100 yards to the Forsyth building and talk to someone who sees the world in a completely different way in the business department. You can walk over to the engineering school. You can head to the history department in McKee. And this place where all these ideas land in the middle of Jackson County, how do you think about Western and the importance of a place like – it's a leading question, I'm sorry. Talk to us about how you feel the role Western Carolina University plays in – helping people shape their ideas and how they see the world?
I was very fortunate. I wound up here at the right time. I wound up here in the right hands. And the truth is, without coming to Western, it doesn't happen, right? Like, it doesn't happen. At the same time, mine was a very, very unique experience in that I can remember sitting at graduation and everybody's sitting there watching the people speak or whatever. And I'm sitting over there reading Thoreau, and I was reading specifically the passage where he says, still we live meanly like ants. And I was looking at all these people and I thought, every one of these people is going to waste their lives working their lives away, and I ain't going to do it. And I haven't. But what I'm getting at is that, you know, certain people wind up in certain places at just the right time, and that's what happened here for me. And I was very fortunate to have, you know, professors who were able to foster those things and those ideas and encourage me in a way that I don't think would have happened anywhere else. And truthfully, though, you look at that and you, and it's not, you know, I'm trying not to speak universally, because I'm sure there are people who come to this school who think I hate it here, and they're gone. And but there are also people like me and all of these other stories that I think about, you know, people, buddies of mine that studied biology and wound up, you know, that's what they, you know, and they wound up in the right hands. And I think more times than not, people tend to wind up in the right hands at this place. And maybe that's the ticket, is that, you know, that seems to happen at a higher rate here than it happens at other places. You tend to develop relationships with teachers in a way that, you know, doesn't happen elsewhere. And a lot of times because it can't. You know, when you're going to a place where it's, a, you know, 200, 300 people in a class, or I don't know how many people are in those big classes, you know, that it can't happen. Versus here, when a big class would be like 30, you know, or something like that. Most of my classes were like 8 to 15, you know, and so there's these really tight, there's a chance to have these really tight-knit relationships develop, you know, and they're able to give you things that they probably wouldn't have the time to do elsewhere.
I love the idea that finding yourself in the right hands tends to happen at a higher rate at this place. I think that's great. Last two questions. First, can you give us the latitude and longitude of your favorite catfish hole? And also, could you give us an update on the next novel? When can we look for it? Yeah. What can you tell us? What are you allowed to tell us? And so we can be on the lookout for it.
Yes, yeah, so anything in the Yadkin River. That's the best, in my mind. That's the best flatheads in the state of North Carolina. Is that anything in the Yadkin? So from High Rock on down into Tuckertown, into Baden, all of those lakes produce really big flathead catfish. And we can go on High Rock anytime. you just say the word and we'll
Yadkin
go down.
Goes all the way back up to Wilkes and
Yadkin
County.
And as far as the next novel, Those We Thought We Knew comes out in August. It's a really interesting book in that it's very, very different from anything else I've ever done. It's bigger in scope. It's bigger in volume. You know, the novel was almost 400 pages, you know, and it took me a very long time to write it. You know, like I said, 5 years. It has some connections to Western. You know, the opening scene takes place on campus. And so it's different in that way, too. But, yeah, it comes out this August.
City Lights doing pre-order?
Yeah.
City Lights Bookstore, our independent bookstore here in Silva, be a great place to go pre-order. We need to get City Lights to be a sponsor for Western Wednesday. We can look into that and say, hey, by the way, we've already booked it for you if you'd like to. Come on, City Lights.
The good thing about Chris and City Lights is that if you pre-order from them, I can sign all of them. You know, you can pre-order from anybody, you know, anywhere you want to buy books, but if you pre-order from them, that's about the only one that, you know, you could guarantee that I'd sign it.
You got that, Sam? All right, we'll make that happen too. Questions?
Oh my gosh, this has been so fun.
Thousands. I know. It truly has. We really appreciate it.
This has been so fun. Thank you.
Anything that you wish we'd asked you?
Mm-mm.
Okay. No. We did. All right.
That was such a great interview with David Joy, class of 2007. Ben, good job on that.
Thanks.
That was, you know, it's funny, like looking back at that interview, there are a couple of questions that maybe you wish you could just grab back for a second. You know, I love how you tee him up for your favorite short story ever, and then he obliterates it.
I went back to Growing Gills because I remember reading it at a different point in my life. And so I went back and I read it ahead of the interview, reread it ahead of the interview, and I sprinkled in, like I had, you know, I was really... I sprinkled in some questions, and there was a line in there about the the fog and the frost of getting out of his car out on Caney Fork before he got in the creek, and like that was so cool. And then he said he said he wished he could take it back, and he used some profanity. And so then I felt like, well, golly gracious. And I wanted to say what I wish I had said was, no, you be proud of that. I don't wish I could take back my eighth grade class photo. It was a point in time, and my bowl cut and Dan Marino jersey still stands to this day. And some people might still find some beauty in that, and I still find beauty.
A photo of Ben with a bowl cut and a Dan Marino jersey is in the show notes. First of all, a photo with Ben with hair and a bowl cut and a Dan Marino jersey. Yeah, no, but you know, I don't want to like put him into an author stereotype, but obviously the longer you do it, the better you get. And the more you look back at your early stuff and go, oh my gosh, I wrote that. Oh, but like to your point though, it still reads. It totally sings.
Oh, it still reads. It absolutely still reads. And so, and James, you wrote a lot and you still write a lot, and your stuff still sings. And so I think that, you know, one of the best things about being able to sit down and talk with someone who's had the success of David Joy is he still finds enormous passion in what he's doing, and he can still draw a line back to Western Carolina University.
That's it.
And that's pretty neat.
That's really cool. It was the same culture building. You know, it was the same third floor, fourth floor, and a lot of the same people. It was great to hear him talk about some of those professors that were in his life, Deidre Elliott, Newt Smith, God rest his soul, Newt. I love Newt. You know, those influences, and Ron, who is still here, of course, but Annette Debo, just great influences. And so, I mean, these are also professors who have taught thousands and thousands of catamounts.
That's across, right.
And not just English majors. This is really special. So, well, folks, you've done it again. You've spent another hour, give or take, listening to us as we talk to these amazing WCU graduates. And we're so glad that you could be part of this episode of Western Wednesdays.
It's great to sit beside you one more time, James.
Oh, you'll do it again.
Well, I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. Special thanks to Sam Wallace, who helped to produce this show. Priya Jaishankar, who was part of the camera team for our interview. And as always, hope you'll keep tuning in. So from here in Cullowhee, go Cats!